Algonquin Books and Workman Audio present Beeswing, Losing My Way and Finding My Voice, 1967 to 1975. Written by Richard Thompson with Scott Timberg. Read by Richard Thompson.
Chapter 1. To Jump Like Alice. There is dust, and then there is dust. It's thickest here in my memory. This remotest room of my mind has been shut up for years, the windows shuttered, the furniture covered with dust sheets. Light hasn't penetrated into some of these corners for years. In some cases, it never has. If something is uncomfortable, I shove it in here and forget about it. When was the last time I dared look? I don't want to remember, but now it's time to think back. The arrow is arcing through the air and speeding towards its appointed target. Then there is the dust of London. When my story begins in the 1960s, the fog is lifting a little. The choking smogs of my childhood, with visibility down to a yard, have been curtailed for the sake of public health by the Clean Air Act of 1956. The dust, dirt, and grime of a million coal fires, hundreds of steam trains, and massive power stations is receding as they are slowly replaced by cleaner fuel. But I miss it. I miss the sulphurous fog that linked you to the London of Sherlock Holmes and Dickens, that inspired visiting French impressionists to paint the city's blurred sunrises and sunsets, and that made everything soft and mysterious. It was part of London, and part of being a Londoner. I suppose even poison is something you can grow fond of. In the spring of 1967, I had just turned 18, and there was another kind of dust in my life entirely, so thick you could see it hang in the air, composed of 50% chalk, 30% boredom, and 20% dull amusement. The dust of school gets into your lungs. Molecules of it are in there still, I swear, clinging to the bronchioles like crabs to a sea wall, even 50 years later. No amount of violent coughing or deep breathing will shift it. It seems to have penetrated my DNA. Maybe that's why I still dream about school, guilty dreams, dreams of unfulfillment, dreams where I'm avoiding, running away, non-confronting. On a sunny day, and the sun still shone in black and white in 1967, you could see the dust hanging in the sunbeams like cigarette smoke caught in the projector beam at the local flea pit. At least I was on the final lap. A few more months, a few more exams, and I would be paroled at last, free after 13 years of incarceration. I had no stomach for further education, and I had no plan A, B, or C. The thought of spending another 3 years in an institution did not appeal. Hospitals, prisons, schools, insane asylums. In Britain, they all seemed to have been designed by the same Victorian sadist and all shared the same decor, urine green and despair grey. I went to a good school, William Ellis Grammar, on the edge of Hampstead Heath. The Heath has been described as the lungs of London, a rural enclave a 15-minute tube ride from the centre of the city. Sitting on London clay and bagshot sand, it could never be built upon with reliability, which saved it from the developers. The school supplied a fair number of candidates to Oxford and Cambridge, and provided a fine education for those who could be bothered. But I drifted through it. I only cared about the guitar. One of my earliest memories, from when I was about 3, is of the attic at 23 Labrick Crescent. Notting Hill, just west of central London, was a fairly run-down area in the early 50s, and our street was pockmarked with shrapnel damage from the war. In fact, one end of the street was a bomb site. It was fenced off, of course, but we kids found a way in and played joyfully among the smashed porcelain, knee-scraping rubble, and broken artifacts of ruined lives. My family, my father, my mother, my sister Perry and I, lived in a flat in the upper half of the house, a few doors down from my mother's father, a number 19. My granddad kept chickens in his back garden, and would often run out into the street with a shovel after a horse and cart had passed by to get the manure for his roses. I remember being taken up to the attic by my parents, presumably so they could keep an eye on me while they looked for something. I had never been in an attic before, so it was a new and thrilling experience. At one point, my father opened a case and pulled out a magical wooden box with strings on it. The box made noises, and you could change them by turning the pegs at the end. My father ran his hands across the strings. It sounded like heaven, and I wanted to hear more, but after a minute or so, he put it back in the case, and I never saw it again. Did he sell it soon afterwards? Perhaps he thought it a luxury at a time when money was tight, but his sound stayed with me. If Dad was not much of a guitarist, he did have plenty of records. In among the albums of show tunes that everyone's parents seemed to own, and the Perry Como and the Gilbert and Sullivan, there were jazz records, Fats Waller, Mead Lux Lewis, Duke Ellington. And among these were lots of guitar 78s. There was the Quintet du Hot Club de France, including the astonishing Django Reinhardt. There was Lonnie Johnson playing with the Louis Armstrong Hot 7. And then there was Les Paul inventing multi-track recording. I remember lying on a sea-green shagpile rug in the living room with my ear a foot from the radiogram speaker. I must have been all of 5 years old. Much of the furniture in the room was mid-century modern G-plan, but the dark walnut radiogram seemed ancient. I liked some of my father's records and disliked others. I seemed to have some sort of critical instinct even at such a young age. Dad would keep up a running commentary on the music in his Cockney-inflected Scottish accent. He talked mostly to himself, reverentially, like a tour guide at the Vatican. Louis Armstrong Hot 5, recorded in 1926. That's Earl Hines on piano. I saw him in Glasgow in the 30s. He always sounded authoritative, but I could tell he was reading most of it off the back of the record sleeve. The next thing he put on grabbed me and held my attention. It started with percussion, before slowly sprouting wings and sounded like nothing I had ever heard. The only thing I could compare it to was the music played on radio or TV programs to evoke alien worlds and life forms. "Caravan," said my father. "That's a Duke Ellington tune played by Les Paul on guitar. He did the whole thing himself." I didn't understand what I was hearing. I only knew that it sounded like it was from Mars and that it was fabulous. I didn't know how to ask to hear it again, so I just waited for the next time. My sister Perry was 5 years my senior, and when rock and roll hit Britain in 1956, first with Bill Haley and then with Elvis, she was strongly identifying with the baby boomer generation. Even back then at the tender age of 12, she pitched a look somewhere between Julie Christie and Brigitte Bardot. I don't remember a time when boys weren't hanging around, and some of them played the guitar and brought over records. Here, at last, was music that was not controlled by the grown-ups. The great watershed had arrived. It was goodbye to the saccharine saxophones of the 1940s, to rationing and austerity, and to your parents' world of wartime sacrifice and post-war peace and quiet. The boomers had arrived, and they wanted it loud, primitive, and exciting. The rock and roll of Jerry Lee, Gene, Eddie, and Buddy started to rumble through the walls from my sister's bedroom. After our family moved to Highgate in the mid-50s to a better, newly built flat, we went to the famous and ancient Hampstead Heath Fair twice a year, and there you could hear rock and roll properly, cranked up loud as a soundtrack to the Dodgems on huge speakers with tons of bass. The sound carried literally for miles. The noise thumped right into your chest and rearranged your intestines. It was a soundtrack for the beautiful ballet of rebellion of the spivs leaping from car to take the money, for the teddy boys going to the insane edge of daring on the switchback to impress their girlfriends. And because my father was born and grew up in Scotland, every summer we would drive up to the Scottish lowlands for a two-week holiday. We would stay with my father's parents in Dumfries for a few days before driving a few more miles to the Solway coast where the family had a chalet. The seaside was special, but I especially loved tagging along with Perry as she explored Dumfries's three coffee bars. Each establishment had a jukebox, and they all played the records loud with tons of low end. At night, I would hang out at the bedroom window and listen to Buddy Holly being played in the cafe three streets away. This music seemed more important than anything else in my life, with the possible exception of model trains and the Beano. Of course, guitars were central to this whole culture. They were starting to crop up on TV, on shows for teenagers like 6-5 Special and Oh Boy. and on the variety show Saturday Night at the London Palladium, which my parents would watch and comment on any rock and roll content. Oh, long-haired layabouts, or what a bloody racket. Joe Brown was probably the first homegrown British guitar hero. He would appear backing the American acts on Oh Boy, and then do a spot on his own. Joe had a winning Cockney manner.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.